Let's pray. Help us, Lord, Father, to do your will. Give us understanding. In Jesus. Amen. 1 Maccabees chapter 2. Read a portion of this story. In those days, Mattathias, the son of John, of the tribe of Simeon, a priest of the sons of Joarib, rose up from Jerusalem and settled in Modin. He had five sons, John called Gaddai, Simon called Thasi, Judas called Maccabeus, Eleazar called Avaran, and Jonathan called Apphus. He saw the blasphemies taking place in Judah and Jerusalem and said, "Alas, why was I born to see this? The ruin of my people, the destruction of the holy city, and to live there when it was delivered into the hand of the enemy, the sanctuary into the hand of foreigners. Her temple has become like a man without honor. Her glorious vessels were carried away into captivity. Her infants have been slain in the streets, her young men with the sword of the enemy. What nation has not inherited her palaces and taken hold of her spoils? All her adornment has been removed. In place of freedom, she has become a slave. And behold, our sanctuary, our beauty, and our glory have been laid waste, and the Gentiles have desecrated it. Why should we live any longer?" Thus Mattathias and his sons tore their clothes, put on sackcloth, and mourned exceedingly. Now those from the king who were enforcing the apostasy journeyed to the city of Modin to make them offer sacrifice, and many from Israel also came with them. So Mattathias and his sons gathered together. Then those from the king spoke to Mattathias, saying, "You are a great and glorious leader in this city and supported by your sons and brothers. Now come, be the first to follow the decree of the king, as all the Gentiles and the men of Judah have done, and those who remain in Jerusalem. And you and your sons will be among the king's friends, and you and your sons will be honored with silver and gold and many rewards." Then Mattathias answered, speaking with a loud voice, "Though all the Gentiles in the house of the kingdom of the king obey him, and each turns from the worship of their fathers and chooses to follow his commands, my sons and my brothers and I will continue in the covenant of our fathers. Far be it from us to forsake the law and the ordinances. We will not obey the words of the king to turn aside from our worship to the right or to the left." When he finished saying these words, a Jew came forward in the sight of everyone to sacrifice upon the altar in Modin in accordance with the king's decree. When Mattathias saw him, he was filled with zeal, and his heart trembled and poured forth anger and judgment. Then he ran and slew him upon the altar. So he killed the king's man who wanted to offer sacrifice at that time. And he tore down the altar. Thus he had zeal for the law, just as Phinehas had against Zimri, the son of Salom. Then Mattathias cried out with a loud voice in the city, saying, "Everyone who has zeal for the law and holds to the covenant, let him follow me." So he and his sons fled into the mountains and left behind whatever they had in the city. Then many who sought righteousness and judgment went down to the desert to live there, they, their sons, their women, and their cattle, because evils increased severely against them. It was also announced to the king's men and the soldiers in Jerusalem, the city of David, that certain men who had scattered when the command of the king was made known had gone into hiding in the desert. Thus many ran after them, tracked them down, marched against them, and engaged them in battle on the Sabbath day. We'll stop there for now. So we see here that this was a tough time in Israel, but we see a man here, and his sons and his brothers just living for the Lord and having a zeal for God And they were just doing, living their lives faithfully to God. And they saw the apostasy that was imposed upon them, and they had a zeal for God. And this is such an inspiring story to me because we face similar things. Maybe not in the same way, but a lot the same. It seems that the apostasy that we're faced with is either a fear of men, as we've noticed in just what I told you before I opened the Bible here, about fearing what men that are supposed to be following Jesus are going to do to you if you follow Jesus. It's ridiculous. Men that are supposed to be loving the kingdom of God, you're fearing what they're going to do to you if you seek the kingdom of God. I mean, what does the truth have to fear? If you've got the truth, keep it. Why are you afraid that, somebody's going to decide that you're wrong? I mean, what is it in us that if we're wrong, we're wrong? But if I'm wrong, I've got to change. What is it that it's just, I don't know, pride, I guess. I don't know. It's a system that they've built. But here this man, he mourned over the desecration of the temple. Over following God, he mourned because of what was coming against them. And he was valiant for God. And it said he was filled with zeal, and his heart trembled and poured forth anger and judgment. And he ran and slew him upon the altar. Can you just imagine here? You got all these men, these king's men, these army and whatever, and they've come to talk to this man, his family, and try to get him to sacrifice. And he said, well, we're not going to do that. I don't care if everybody does it. We're not going to do that. And then just despite him, a Jew that should have been faithful to what he was saying he was going to be faithful to, despite him, showed him right in his face, went up there and sacrificed on the altar. He just was filled with zeal and just took over the situation. Took it upon himself right there. And then cried out with a loud voice saying, everyone who has zeal for the law and holds to the covenant, let him follow me. Do you think all the years before this and all the time that he was just being faithful, do you think he was thinking, I just can't wait till somebody goes up there and sacrifices on that altar so I can kill him and be a big guy here? Probably never even thought about that. Who would have even thought of that, to do that, or that it would come to that? But it didn't take that for him to be this man at this hour, at this time. It doesn't take aspiring to be somebody great or doing something really spectacular for God to be that man at that time. These are examples, and all through the Bible, just before this, Esther, who knows but what you've come to the kingdom, but for such a time as this. Do you think she was faithful? Do you think she was obedient to Mordecai her whole life growing up? Thinking that one of these days I'm going to be queen. He's going to choose me as queen. I'm going to make this happen. It's going to work out great. She never even thought about being queen. I mean, she was a Jew. Why would she be a queen to a Persian king? No, she was just being faithful. She was just loving the Lord, loving God. So was this man, just loving God, doing what came next. Just do the next right thing, my wife says. Just do the next right thing. And that's what they were doing. And that's what I want to talk about this morning. You know, well, I want to read a little story. Probably never heard this story. Then again, you may have. Probably have, actually. Said a hare to a tortoise, "Good sir, what a while. You have been only crossing the way. Why, I really believe that to go half a mile, you must travel 2 nights and a day." "I'm very content," the creature replied, "though I walk but a tortoise's pace. But if you think proper to the point to decide, we will run half a mile in a race." "Very good," said the hare, said the tortoise, "proceed, and the fox shall decide who has won." Then the hare started off with incredible speed, and the tortoise walked leisurely on. "Come, tortoise, friend tortoise, walk on," said the hare. "Well, I shall stay here for my dinner." "Why, 'twill take you a month at that rate to get there. Then how can you hope to be winner?" But the tortoise could hear not a word that she said, for he was far distant behind. So the hare felt secure, whilst at leisure she fed, and took a sound nap when she dined. So at last the slow walker came up with the hare, and there, fast asleep, he did spy her. And he cunningly crept with such caution and care, that she woke not, although he passed by her. "Well now," thought the hare when she opened her eyes, "for the race, and I soon shall have done it." But who can describe her chagrin and surprise when she found that the tortoise had won it? You know, that's so true. We're so much like the hare. If we can't be out front, then we're just going to stop. We're just not going to do it. So get out front. We want to go out front. We want to do great things. We're off out in the lead, and we're doing great things, and everything's going great. We feel like it anyway. Hey, we got this under control. No problem. So we kick back, take it easy, slow down, stop, take a nap. And then we miss out. When we ought to be like the tortoise, who just takes it one step at a time, one step at a time, one step at a time. Every day, one step at a time. And then when it comes time for that finish line, we'll do that one step at a time. People, when something great happens, somebody's involved in some heroic event, people will question them and say, "What? How did you do that? What?" They just did the next thing. They just did what was right. They just did what was right before them. The man that jumped in the river, freezing cold river off of a bridge because he saw a woman was drowning. They asked, what made you do that? Do you want to be a hero? He said, "No, I just saw a lady drowning." Anybody would have done that. You know? I mean, probably not anybody would, because most people are self-centered so much that they're just scared they're going to save themselves. Do you think that this man that ran up and slew that Jew, that apostate Jew, cared much for his own safety? He didn't care much for his own safety. But he had already not been caring much for his own safety throughout his life. He had already not been a self-centered person throughout his life. Esther had already not been a self-centered person in her life. She was scared because she knew to go into the king without being summoned could mean death. Probably would mean death. But she had already lived expecting to become an old man's wife. And she was living that way. She was accepting that. So, the course that's before us, that's what I want to talk about. You know, let's turn to Romans chapter 2. I like this in Romans that it talks about what I'm going to read here, because so many people that quote Romans quote just the opposite, or try to make Romans say the opposite of what this says here. Romans chapter 2, we'll start in verse 6, cut in here. It's talking about God, who will render to each person according to his deeds. To those who by perseverance in doing good seek for glory and honor and immortality, eternal life. They will get eternal life. But to those who are selfishly ambitious and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, they'll get wrath and indignation. There will be tribulation and distress for every soul of man who does evil, of the Jew first and also of the Greek. But glory and honor and peace to everyone who does good, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. That's pretty simple. That's just laid out right there. But though, to those who by perseverance in doing good, you know, sometimes it just gets so weary, doesn't it? It just gets so weary. You just get tired of just being good. You know, I mean, for lack of a better word, it's just tiring. And that's the devil. He wants to wear us out. He wants to wear us down and just say, what's this all for? And we get to, it's just, you know, if we can't be doing something great, then we'd just rather not do it at all, you know. But what about just stay in the course, staying hooked, the daily grind? You know, when I get a piece of wood or furniture that I want to sand, the first sandpaper I get is coarse, because I want to do something quick. I don't want to get 300 grit or whatever and start sanding on something that's got old paint on it, because that's not going to get very far very quick. So I get some 40 grit or some 80 grit and I get going, and it's really coarse. And then we go to the lesser grit and we get lesser and we get it polished up. And, you know, we want to see quick results, either in ourselves or in someone else. And, you know, sometimes that's necessary. There are some things that we need to knock off pretty easy, pretty quick. But generally speaking, the daily grind of life that polishes us, a really fine grit. And it doesn't show quick results, but it's still working. It still works. And, you know, we may have dropped off a lot of big sins, knocked off the big stuff right away. But the thing that really polishes us, that God uses, is those tiny abrasions that just are hardly detectable, and even to the immediate touch feel smooth. But as it works on our lives and our hearts and our minds and spirits, it's little by little. It's the things that we daily come in contact with that make the difference. It's the little foxes that spoil the vines. It's the little things that make us where God can use us when it comes to time like it was in Israel here. That's why it's important for us. And the Bible talks over and over and over about this. I've got a lot of scriptures. I probably won't turn them all, but but we can turn to Hebrews chapter 6. Verse 10. Well, start 9. But beloved, we are convinced of better things concerning you and things that accompany salvation, though we are speaking in this way. For God is not unjust so as to forget your work and the love which you have shown toward his name in having ministered and in still ministering to the saints. And we desire that each one of you show the same diligence so as to realize the full assurance of hope until the end, so that you will not be sluggish but imitators of those who through faith and patience inherit the promises. For when God made the promise to Abraham, since he could swear by no one greater, he swore by himself, saying, I will surely bless you, and I will surely multiply you. And so, having patiently waited, he obtained the promise. Sometimes, that's probably the hardest thing in the world for me, is to wait. And I hate to keep people waiting on me. I think that's an injustice that we do to others, and so that's just waiting is something I don't want to do, and I don't want others to have to do it. But sometimes I cause that to happen to others, and sometimes I have to wait on others. But when we think about waiting to be better, or waiting to be more fitted, or waiting to be more what we need to be in the kingdom, or waiting for whatever, waiting for God's timing in our lives, waiting for someone to, hoping someone repents and turns around, life is full of waiting. Life is full of, and then what do you do in the meantime? What do you do while you wait? What did Abraham do while he waited? Well, through faith and patience, he inherited the promises. Was faith dead or dormant at that time? No, it was busy. He was doing things. He was just, and if you read in Jasher, the book of Jasher, it says that Abraham built a house where two roads crossed, and he received everyone into that house and gave them clothes, food, and spoke to them of the Lord and things of the Lord. And he was known just for his hospitality and his goodness. He was a good man. But that's how he waited. Was he doing great things and valiant things and fighting battles? No, he wasn't. But when it came time to fight a battle, he did it. And he was victorious. Hebrews chapter 10. Verse 32. But remember the former days when, after being enlightened, you endured a great conflict of sufferings, partly by being made a public spectacle through reproaches and tribulations, and partly by becoming sharers with those who were so treated. For you showed sympathy to the prisoners and accepted joyfully the seizure of your property, knowing that you have for yourselves a better possession and a lasting one. Isn't that just a little footnote there? A better possession. Is that the way we treat the kingdom of God? Is that what we think of the kingdom of God as? Something better than whatever we own? And one that lasts, as opposed to one that doesn't last. Therefore, do not throw away your confidence, which has a great reward. For you have need of endurance, so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what was promised. For yet, in a very little while, he who is coming will come and will not delay. But my righteous one shall live by faith, and if he shrinks back, my soul has no pleasure in him. But we are not of those who shrink back to destruction, but of those who have faith to the preserving of the soul. Shrinking back. You know, seems like life is full of challenges and bumps and hurdles, and they, when you're in them, it seems like they're just torment, just can I even bear this? But after a while and you're through it, it's look back, yeah, that was a challenge, but that's gone now. Now here I am. What am I doing now? But God is interested in you being the greatest thing you can do in the kingdom of God, which I hope we're all aspiring to be faithful servants of God. I trust we are, or we wouldn't be here. And so because we're aspiring to that and we want that and these things are encouraging to us, the greatest thing that we can do to make that happen today is just be faithful today. In 1 Timothy 6:6, it says, but godliness actually is a means of great gain when accompanied by contentment. Some people it's talking about uses godliness to get gain. They use godly things to get gain. They make a business out of it. They want to appear big or important. But godliness actually is a means of great gain when accompanied by contentment. See, if you're content to just face life day to day, then you're in a state of readiness. For we have brought nothing into this world, so we cannot take anything out of it either. If we have food and covering with these, we shall be content. But those who want to get rich fall into temptation and snare and many foolish and harmful desires. And that's talking about riches, which I'm not really talking about that, but that's pertinent, of course. But what I'm talking about, those who want to get rich with God, those who want to make strides in the kingdom, and they want to go forward and just be somebody and be something, be a missionary, be a songwriter, be whatever. But patience, contentment. Be where God wants you right now and be everything you can be right now, so that when that Jew comes and sacrifices on that altar, you're ready to take action. And it'll be right. Paul said, you don't have to turn there, I'll just read it. He told Timothy, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the course. I have kept the faith. In the future, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not to me only, but also to all who have loved his appearing. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the course. I have kept the faith. You know, you read that and say, wow, that's neat. He finished right. He did good. Well, how long did that take him? Was that just as long as it takes to read it? Was that maybe a year or two? No, it took a long time. He went through a whole lot. And you can read some of the list of the things that he went through, and wherever it is. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 Corinthians chapter 7. Yeah. In Corinthians. But anyway, that is just some of the things he went through up to that point. And then who knows what he went through after he wrote that. But finishing, I have fought the good fight. So he had to fight. It's not just a nice thing. I fought the good fight. You know, we hear that. Yeah, okay, fought the good fight. He fought. And he said in another place, not as one that beats the air, but I fight to win. But now at the end of his life, he's saying, I fought the good fight. And sometimes our fights are with ourselves more than anybody else. I have finished the course. You know, the tortoise, he finished the course, didn't he? He finished the course. That's what we need to finish, the course. We need the course, though. That's where we're at right now. We haven't finished it, but we're in it. We're in a course. We think about a course or a way that's laid out before us to run through all kinds of obstacles and this obstacle course, this track, this way to go. It's going to have everything to try to keep us from making it, so that only those who make it are worthy. I have kept the faith. So there's something to keep. There's something to be keeping right now. And that's what we're called to do. We have a faith. There's one faith, not many. One Lord, not many. And are we keeping it? That's what's before us. You know, they say that the best wine is the oldest, or the best cheese is the oldest, or older, it's been aged. And that's the way it is in the Christian life. That's why the Bible says don't ordain a novice, someone that's young in the faith. But there's, and the Bible talks about the hoary head and the wisdom of the aged. It's because they've got some things behind them. They've got some experience. They've got some things to give you something from. In the future, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have loved his appearing. Who have loved his appearing. That's a state of being that we're in. Do we love his appearing? Finally, in James chapter 5, verse 7. Therefore be patient, brethren, until the coming of the Lord. The farmer waits for the precious produce of the soil, being patient about it until it gets the early and late rains. You too be patient, strengthen your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is near. Do not complain, brethren, against one another, so that you yourselves may not be judged. Behold, the judge is standing right at the door. As an example, brethren, of suffering and patience, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. We count those blessed who endured. You have heard of the endurance of Job and have seen the outcome of the Lord's dealings, that the Lord is full of compassion and is merciful. We have all kinds of examples of patience, of suffering, of men in the Bible. And then we read of their some hour that they had. But what about all the ones that you don't read about? What was going on in the lives of the 7,000 who had not bowed the knee to Baal, that were faithful to God yet? I don't know. We don't know those things. There's countless stories, surely, of people who were just faithful. What was going on in the life of Anna in the temple, who was faithful to God for 80-something years there, just serving the temple, just serving God in the temple? Or Zacharias and Elizabeth, or any of them. We don't know all those things. We don't know. All we know is that when it came time because they had endured. They had stayed the course. They had been patient, and they continued day by day by day. And when they failed, they got up again. No doubt many of them did fail. We know David did. It shows that. And others questioned and wondered and struggled. But those that endured to the end were saved. Word of encouragement there for us. May the Lord bless you. Pray for our brethren that they would return safe. And the Lord would grant us that blessing. Let's pray for one another. Love one another. Bear one another's burdens where we can. Encourage each other. And fight on. Run.